States of America.
That before an announcement was made, the government forced them to cap it and seal the record to document the fact. Then Captain Williams says, why? At that point, I decided it was time for somebody to tell the story. And the scandal greater than Watergate. Chaplain, it's good to have you, and the last time you were on with me, if I remember correctly, oil was at about $29 to $32 a barrel, and you had the audacity to predict that it would go down to $15. And now look what it's doing.
Oh, there's been some exciting things happening in energy and oil since I was here. I'm predicting at this point that it will go to $9 a barrel and stay there for a week or two of time until they have accomplished what they want. What do they want? Well, most Americans believe that the private enterprise oil companies are the ones that are doing this, or maybe OPEC and the Arab cartel. Quite the contrary. That's kind of what they will have to use as a scapegoat. Let's find out who originally built the Arab oil fields, who finds them, who it is that manipulates from the very top, day by day, the price of oil from the computers, where they get down and decide what it's going to be. And when we dig all the way to the bottom, we'll find out that the identical same money manipulators that manipulate the Federal Reserve System are likewise manipulating the price of oil for the purpose of breaking the Arab economy.
That's too big.
Well, let's dig a little further. Who are we talking about? Well, in order to dig, I think I must establish some credibility, Marlon, because many in the listening audience will be new. I will be new to them, even though they listen to you every day. But let's go back to 1973, when I was a missionary in the state of Alaska. And that was the year that they announced they were going to build that big 4-foot diameter pipeline across the state of Alaska from the monstrous new oil pond called Pluto Bay on the Arctic Ocean in northern Alaska. That year, being a missionary, and wanting to help my country out of the problem it was in, I decided the best way to do it was to build a pipeline and build that pipeline. And what better way for a missionary to do that than to be a chaplain on the Trans-Alaska Oil Pipeline? So I went to the oil companies, and I said, don't you need a chaplain? Well, they said, we don't have anything to pay you. I said, no problem. If you don't pay me, you can't tell me what to preach. Just allow me in the camps. Well, they did. And about 6 months later, the oil companies came to us chaplains and said, we can't pay you anything. That was in the original agreement. But you're saving us so many thousands of dollars in counseling fees. We want to make life a little easier for you. We're going to give you executive status. And for the next 2.5 years, I was allowed to sit in on board meetings, watch wells brought in, fields tested, could see data, information that the average person would not have access to. I never snooped. I only saw what I was allowed to see and was invited in to see. But what I saw totally changed my life. I realized there was no gasoline shortage in the early 70s.
But this is during the time that people were lined up for blocks to get gas.
But we were told we had a shortage.
Yeah, there was a story we're running out of gas.
The truth of the matter was, we had as much of a glut of oil back then as we have right now. Now, let's bring this to 1986. Right where we're living here today in April. And find out what's happening. We today still have the identical same glut of oil that we had back in the early 70s. In fact, if anything, we're using more oil today than we were using then because population has increased. Yet they say that the prices are plummeting because of a glut. Yet 3 weeks ago, I was in Canada. The week that I was there, Canada announced they were going to cut their oil output from the world 40% on a particular day. They did. Yet prices still keep on plummeting. Yet OPEC's cutting back. In fact, these prices still keep plummeting. Now, if we have this glut we're talking about, but the truth of the matter is we had as much of a glut back in the early 70s as we have today, then doesn't it stand to reason that OPEC is not producing the downward spiral of oil prices? Neither are the private enterprise oil companies of America or any place in the world.
Now, have you just eliminated the two people that can do it?
We have eliminated the ones that we just eliminated, the ones that we have told.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Now, let's go to find out who really is doing it. In order to do that, I must mention the name Tim Kwan. Tim may be that the people that are under this deal. He's the Mr. X of my book, The Energy Non-Crisis. September 1985, he called me on the phone and he said, Lindsay, I've just come back from Dubai, the Arab country where I've been producing the oil fields and the related refineries for the Arab field, and he said, I think you'd be interested in some things I have to say. plummet in oil prices as a result of on group steel has sold everything east of the Mississippi. They've gotten rid of Anaconda. We've cut back on everything that cost us money.
We're living this time.
We're up while shooting them now. After all, it's been planned for the past year's time to plummet oil prices as of a set date. Now, he didn't know the exact date. All he knew was that he knew it was planned. He knew it was coming.
Yeah.
He knew it was planned. He told me he did. And he told me why he did. And it's for September. I predicted it right here. I didn't know he was in there.
Yeah.
Now, let's go back to why he told me it was going to happen. He said, Lindsay, there are less than 300 Sheikhs and Sheikhs in the country of Dubai. But yet there are a few million people who are sprawled in abject slavery almost in a military dictatorship. Now, he said, those Sheikhs and Sheikhs were nomads running the deserts, riding camels 25 years ago. Today, their kids are in stretched Mercedes out in the desert, playing chicken in their automobiles. He could have no sense of the value. They're living in their ivory palaces and living in their gold-lined cities, and they have created an economy that is phenomenal right out in the middle of the desert. Now, he said, Lindsay, what's happening was, back in those days, the internationalists went in and found oil in those Arab countries because of windfall profits taxes and others in America. They made it unprofitable for oil to be produced in America. You could import it cheaper. And back in those days, he said, oil went to $31, $32 a barrel, and the Arabs were told by these people who had financed their oil fields, and after the oil fields were paid off and they got all the countryside out and they could get out of them, they were persuaded to invest. But he said, remember what gold prices were back in those days. He said, time that the Arab oil fields, about the time they'd been paid off, and the Arabs were raking in all of this money, why the gold went to $600, $700 an ounce, went up to $800 an ounce at one time. And the internationalists told the Arabs, buy. Buy gold. Buy gold. Buy securities. Buy T-bills, treasury bills. And he said, they did. Then he said, they ought to let the Arab economy stay right where they wanted it until they built all of these gold-lined cities, so to speak, and established the economy they wanted to establish. Then he said, the people who had created all of this for the Arabs decided it's time to do the opposite. So they took gold to $300-$320 an ounce. Then by manipulating the market in the marketplace, they plummeted the price of oil by claiming we have a glut, which we have a glut just as much by many other sellers. Now they plummeted the price of oil to, by the way, last week went under $10 a barrel for the first time. My prediction is $9 a barrel for quite a few months, maybe a few years. And so they're going to plummet the price of this oil to $15, maybe $9 a barrel. And $9 a barrel was his actual low figure back in September. And he said, Lindsay, they'll keep it there. Well, they have. Now, remember, there are less than 300 Sheikhs and Sheikhs in Dubai. But a few million people, have been put on a welfare state. They're used to this. What happens is that somebody is going to pull the rug out from under them. Yes, in fact, the rug is being pulled out from under them at this point because this economy that has been created by these few hundred people for the millions that are living under them. As soon as oil prices plummet, in order to keep the servitude that they place the other people in line, they must cash in their securities in order to maintain the economy that they created in the desert. So what do? They sell their gold. But remember, they bought it at the peak of the oil flood, so they said, that $600-$700 an ounce. Now they're selling it back to the identical same people who have manipulated the crash of the oil price. They're selling it back to them for $300-$320 an ounce. Remember that these international financiers created the problem, and then they created a solution. So now they're trying to sell back their T-bills. And I was on a certain program, talk show the other day, and a man called in, and he said, I'm an Arab. He said, what Mr. Williams is saying is correct, but he said, I'd like to go a step further. He said, Saudi Arabia last week, taking a large amount of treasury bills, T-bills, United States Treasury, and asked to cash in because they need the securities. And he said, the Treasury said, sorry, we can't cash them.
You think George Bush is over there now?
Very well could be.
That's something you believe in?
Very well could be. But now that they can't cash in the Treasury notes, because after all, America's in trouble too. If the Arabs cashed in, we'd be in miserable shape because the
getting in trouble. They get back here at foreclosed, get back here and operate. It just sounds like you're talking about the Iowa farmers, too. The Iowa farmers are in that identical same situation. Remember that they loaned the money, yeah, the purchasing power of the silver dollar a few years ago.
Yeah.
And then they asked them to pay back that purchasing power of the Federal Reserve paper note today, which I like to call a green stamp. All the time, the bankers knew that they were just the problem for the price of the compound within 5 years. It's the identical same scenario. But then the same thing has happened to airlines. And the biggest airline, the biggest fiasco of airlines. I was in Miami, Florida on February 23, 1986, when Eastern Airlines was negotiated for sale. And I picked this one up, which I had in Miami Herald in my hand dated that day. Remember, let's go back a ways. Remember Texas International went under about 4 years ago, and then after that, Continental Airlines went under about 3 years ago, and we really didn't think too much about it. But at the time, there was a financing firm in New York that no one had ever heard the name of before. They bought out Texas International, then bought out Continental, and some of us wondered at the time, who is that firm? Then it came down time for Eastern Airlines, and Eastern Airlines said, we can't negotiate with the unions if we have to pay what the unions asked for. We'll go under Eastern just broke anyway. And within 24 hours' time, they negotiated the sale of Eastern Airlines, the second largest carrier in the free world. It was unheard of. You don't do that in 24 hours. But when we look back as to who bought them, it was the identical same financing firm in New York a few years ago, regarding insignificant, that bought Texas International, that bought out Continental, and now buying out Eastern Airlines. And then, the very next day, I was in Los Angeles. I'd gone from Miami to Los Angeles for a speaking engagement, and just a few days later, I should say, on March 7th, 1986, the Los Angeles Times business section, the San Diego section, said, in the last 4 weeks, airlines have returned the favor. Merger waves turned airline stocks into high flyers, say Mr. L.F. Rothschild.
Rothschild?
Quite interesting.
You're seeing Rothschild?
And then he goes on to predict, of all things, who will be the next airline to go to London. He says Pacific Southwest Airlines, PSA, Western Airlines, Alaska Airlines, Aloha Airlines. Then when I left Los Angeles, and I just happened to pick up the Wall Street Journal that morning, and was reading it on the airplane as I flew back north for another speaking engagement. It says Western Airlines takeover. Now, this is dated just a few days later, on March 12th, 1986, and watch the sequence of events. Again, Delta Airlines takes the Wall Street Journal, and then we come down to March the 27th out of the Minneapolis Star Tribune, and it says Delta Western rumor. Now, notice what they're doing. They collapse the air economy. They put America's economy into a tailspin it's in by deindustrialization. The airlines are having problems because of high fuel prices and other things. Now, it's to their advantage to buy out the airlines.
Why? But why would they be interested in airlines as opposed to something else?
Well, they're getting... Well, let's start off, first of all, the oil companies. Now, they're in bad trouble. They got AT&T in 1983, the largest private enterprise on the face of the earth, American telephone telegraph. The third largest private enterprise in America is farmers.
Mm-hmm.
And they're getting them by, understand, 30% of farmers in America will not even have the money to plant this money. They might not have the money to loan.
We get letters from them all the time and saying you're selling our farms.
Yeah. And then they're getting the banks. All the private owned lending institutions in America will go into bankruptcy in the next few years' time.
Who will go into bankruptcy?
Every private owned lending institution in America within the next few years' time will go under.
Wasn't there a giant that just toppled in?
Oh, was there a giant? In fact, I just took the article out of your Houston newspaper, I think, this week. What was it? They said the largest, the largest failure in the history of banking. Here it is right here. In fact, I have the Dallas Morning News, April 5th, 1986, headlines, Houston Thrift Fails. And it says, federal regulators declared 1 billion mainland savings association in Houston insolvent, the largest savings and loan failure in the history of the United States of America. That took place on April 5th, 1986. Back on Friday afternoon. And yet they say we're in better economy than the economy is looking up. Quite the contrary. Now, why is all this being done? There's a reason. Let's take a scenario that would come right down home where the
average listener here is an